Yeah, we are from the club station Charlie 25. Charlie 25 is based in Erding. Erding is around about 20-25 kilometers east of Munich, not north. But it doesn't matter. A wonderful small town, and where we are a group of four people. We decided for around about 3 years to start with a simple project for our youngsters, go more in the techniques and so on, and therefore we started with a simple CV transceiver based on a stick, an SDR stick, and we end up with a complete SDR transceiver for all ham bands. So this could be also a chance for you to start small and think big. Yeah. So therefore, let us start. At first I will show you our team. This is Edwin, Delta Charlie 9 Oscar Echo. Then we have Markus, Delta Golf 8 Mike Golf. The next Markus, we have a lot of Markus, you see also here. The next Markus is Delta Lima 8 Golf Mike and myself. This team is now working since 3 years together, and we meet us every week twice to go through the steps we want to do. And this is, at first, thank you very much, guys. It was always, over the 3 years, a good job, and we had always fun. And I think this is very good for a club station to have this one. Yeah. So, came to the technique much more. At first, it was a simple thing. Okay, we have some digital processing, analog, digital, and then we need a front end and a little bit a user interface, and then it is. Yes, principle, yes. In the real world, it was a little bit more difficult. Our concept looks like, in this case, we have the RapidTire as the base. Then we have a filter, Eric's filter board. We have a PA with some low pass in it. No, zurück. Mit der Maus hier vorne auf den Roden. And then we have also the possibility for increasing and decreasing our signal strengths from around about 36 plus 36 to minus 36 dB. You can control it in this range so that you have really a good signal for your transceiver. And when you see, go on a TX button with the mouse. Okay, and then you see how it works. We go through the RX filter so that we have an absolutely clear signal when we go to the PA, and this brings us also a very nice advantage for the output signal. And when we go to receiving, please see also the blinking is on the right way. Yeah, red goes out and green comes in. Yeah, so this is working in this way. So I think it's simple, but it's a nice concept, and it works great for us. Some details, what we have done for sure, we cover the complete ham band, include 60 meter. We can also go down, we can also go 470 kilohertz if you want to transmit, but then you have to put a homebrew filter in it and you can use this one. So it's not a point of our concept, it's a point more of the filtering you put in. Good, then 12 band preselector. This is also very nice. You have to see when you came to the DRSC area where we are based, you can see the real transceiver, and you can also see, let me say, our filter concept and how it works, and this is really nice. It's a dream for the amateur radios. Okay, and then you can also do, let me say, all the digital modes, because you have the possibility with virtual cables to go in and out for this way, and you can also connect every type of digital software behind this one. Yeah. Good.
Jetzt kann ich sprechen. Okay, wunderbar. Okay, good morning everybody, and thanks for joining us. It's really a pleasure and nice to see so many people are being interested in SDR and RapidTire and what we are doing. So I would like to talk a little bit about the technical challenges we are faced with when using RapidTire. I think many of you are using one already. Can you put your hands up who is using one already? Okay. So many of you know what the challenges are. You know, first of all, sensitivity is limited, and there are some common methods available to overcome this. And one is to change the little plug from pin 2 to 5. This shortcuts the attenuator, and then you can put a transformer in there. We are using a 1 to 14 from mini circuits, but you can also wind your own one, 1 to 16, you wouldn't notice any difference. So this is a good and easy message. So it has benefits because it's easy to implement and it's pretty simple, and it gives you a sensitivity of about minus 113 dBm to 118 dBm, which I think is in a normal range for an SDR radio. But it has also some disadvantages. It is limiting your dynamic range, and it's also limiting your large signal handling capability. So if you put a large signal on it with a two-tone generator, you will see that this is not the best possible method. Wait a second. And so basically, if you look at the Red Pitaya without the transformer, the signal handling capability is pretty good. And also, I know IP3 doesn't mean much for software-defined radios. I used it as a reference here. I was measuring 32 dBm of IP3, which is pretty reasonable. But I think a better approach would be to take all the front-end analog stuff out and go directly on the analog-digital converter and on the digital-analog converter. And I know some people have done it. I've seen DC6HL, for example, has done some work on it. And we, therefore, have asked our friends from Red Pitaya. Chet was so nice and friendly and built us a special Red Pitaya without the front-end, if you go further. Before I talk about this new front-end, I also need to talk about another issue. We found that when we want to transmit on 6 meter, the performance was pretty bad. We could only get an intermodulation of minus 28 dBc. And when we analyzed where the problem comes from, we found that it is the operational amplifier in the Red Pitaya is not very good on 6 meter. And we replaced it by another one, so you can take it out. It's not too difficult to take it out and change it to a better operational amplifier. We used an OPA 695 for this reason, and your IMD goes from minus 28 to minus 43, which I think is well worth changing the operational amplifier and getting some better signals. Okay, and then of course we built some filter stuff, and you will, if you come to our booth, our DRRC booth over there, we have a full-blown transceiver with those filters, the prototype of those filters being built in. So we have built 12 of those filters, one for each band. It's currently a prototype, but we plan to produce it, and it will be available as a commercial version. I don't know what the price will be yet, because those things are pretty difficult to adjust, and also there's a lot of coil winding. I have done all the coil windings myself here on this prototype, so it's no fun. It's 12 bends by 4 coils, so you can imagine how much coil winding it is. But anyway, it performs pretty well. You see on the right side what the performance is on 20 meter. You have a real sharp filter. And this is the only way to make useful sense from the preamplifier, because the preamplifier has very broad bandwidth. And if you switch on the preamplifier, you preamplify everything that comes from your antenna. So it makes a lot of sense to have a nice filter up front. So then I think Chet talked already a little bit about the problem on 6 meter and why he is not selling it for 6 meter currently. When you use Red Pitaya on 6 meter, you will find some spurs. And this signal can hardly be used to transmit anything, so it's pretty useless. But we are putting the signal through our RX filters. As you have seen, the filters are very small, and then the signal becomes pretty clean. So in our next transceiver design, before we use the output of Red Pitaya for transmission, we put the output signal through the RX filters, and then we have a very clean output. Okay, And now comes the bot I talked about. The guys from Red Pitaya were so nice to prepare an extra bot for us. So all the front-end analog stuff has been taken out. No amplifiers anymore in the output, and no amplifiers anymore in the input. And I just want to share with you what the results are. I talked about an IP3 measurement of 32 dBm. So this is what Red Pitaya does without the transformer. I must say, if you put the transformer on, it looks much worse. But if you don't put the transformer on and you put minus 3 dBm in there with a two-tone signal, you get a sensitivity of 95 dBm and you get some distortion, as you can see here, from it. And on the other side, you see the modified Red Pitaya, and you don't see any distortions anymore. So it's much more capable of handling large signals when you take all the analog stuff out. And we are pretty pleased with it now. And also the sensitivity, sensitivity goes up. This is another positive aspect. So the sensitivity is now in the range of 110 to minus 115 dBm. And what is even more important, you can really use the second receiver now. We had some crosstalk problems on the second receiver, and I think many of you who have used Red Pitaya already would have noticed that there's some crosstalk between the channels. And the crosstalk is now at minus 80 dB, which is very, very good. And now we can make use of the second receiver, and we can build a transceiver with two full-blown receiver channels. Okay, and then, of course, to have some fun, I also tried with no Elias filter in the front end anymore. I tried to see if I could use this thing on 2 meter and on 4 meter. So here you see the 2 meter signal with some filtering. And here you see the 4 meter signal without filtering. This was only because I had some ready-made filter available, and I tested it on 2 meter, and I didn't have a filter available for 4 meter. So here's a 4 meter signal. So 2 meter and 4 meter can be done. I need to do more work on the filtering and see if I can get the signal clean enough to make a nice 2 meter and 4 meter transceiver out of it. But our plan is to really integrate 2 and 4 meters in our transceiver concept, so that at the end we come up with a transceiver that goes from 160 meter to 2 meter. That's basically the idea. Okay, what's next? Next level? You want to talk about next level or me? You can talk about next level.
So you can stay in the corner.
Wait a second, I need to find this magic switch.
Yep, magic switch. Okay, so on the end, we have our first step after 3 years. We have a transceiver that is working as SDR transceiver, a software-defined radio. We learned a lot in this case. Yeah, really, I must say, wonderful. It was a hard work, but we have also dreams and wishes. And some dream and wishes, for sure, 2 meter or higher is one. But also we have some steps what are shown here. Yeah? And one of the points is for sure that we have a coupler inside where we can measuring the forward and the reverse power so that we can show directly the SVR. This is a very nice thing, very simple, but a very nice thing. You have it. Yeah? One of them is also that, as I told you, with the Elias frequency, so you can go up with the higher transmission of your frequency. This is one. Then testing maybe a new clock for that. We will see how does this work. This is what we have to do. Also, we want to implement a GPS system. The dream is to have, let me say, a QSO with you on 1 hertz. This was a dream. If you can really adjust on 1 hertz. Yeah, this was a very small band communication. For example, yeah. Then transverter, yes, transverter is also an interesting thing. And for some reason, some people need also a little bit more power. I'm more the QRP people, not so the high power, but we design also a 250 watts module, what you can implement so that you have an output power instead of 10 to 250 watts. What we are currently really hard working is this one. Upcoming pre-distortion due to the effect that this is working, yes, we know all, It is working on a very, very small adjustment, or a window, let me say, working window. We developed an RF coupler with automatically gain switching so that we can go in this way. And we will see maybe end of this year this will run in our system. So currently it's not so running as we want to have it. Yeah. And the next one, yeah, noise cancelling. Due to the situation, as you know, with all the PLC and all the things we have in our environmental, I think noise cancelling is a very, very important thing. And with a crosstalk now of, let me say, 80 dB, so we have the possibility also to improve these noise cancelling figures. We will see what is the outcome. Yeah? I have done a concept, Ryan, let me say, manually built up, not with the Rapid Tire, and it was a dream. We had a lot of problems in our club station, yeah, with, how can I say it, heating machine in the cellar, you know, or heating up the room. This makes a lot of noise, terrible. And the concept, like this one here, I tested it in a separate area, and it was dream because we had 9 plus 10, 9 plus 20 dB on noise level, and I reduce it to 1. And you can hear now signals were coming up with 5, 6 S-meter stream. Yeah. It works, great, okay. Next one. So, now on the, before we go to the software part, hopefully we have enough time. We want 5 minutes, so. Before we go to the software part, during all the things we have done over the 3 years, for sure, it was a lot of work from our side, but we have a very, very good community in the world. Tipp einfach durch langsam. So, and I put some words on it. I think when you read the words, it comes up in your mind. What does it mean? A lot of knowledge, a lot of internationally working, a lot of connections we have to a global SDR, or software-defined radio community. We work with a lot of people. Beside Pavel, we have people in US, where we give some software for testing, because also US is thinking totally different. Yeah, Asian is different. They want to have the button left and right, or whatever. But think a little bit. If we could focus us on some projects, and we bring the people together, how powerful we could produce or development things. We do it for nothing. We do it for free. We do it for everyone. We go sleeping, American can work. American gets sleeping, Asian is working. In the morning you wake up and say, wow, wonderful, next level. Yeah? Can you imagine how much power we could have when we are focused us on some projects? No company has this development power. Okay, only just to think about. Because software-defined radio over the last years was tremendous increasing, and I never saw so much people working again on this, let me say, fantastic area. How is working Superhead? You see? Superhead receiver? Oh! Wow! Yes! SDR? Yes, I know it! Yeah? This is the difference. It's new. It's okay. The point is that we have fun, we work on that, we develop something. This is what we want to do. And this is also, let me say, our experience will be working every day. Yeah? So, therefore, next one is software. Short, please.
Thanks, Erwin. So, let me start with the software part. This is just a screenshot of my current development version of the Power SDR Charlie 25 HemLab and StemLab edition. And I want to talk about the extension I've built in. into the, let's say, base version that I'm using. I'm using the open HBSDR, PowerSDR version, where Whiskey5, Whiskey Charlie from the US is the main developer. He is currently on version 3.4.2, and I'm also on this version, so I'll always try to keep it up to date, our Charlie 25 Hamlab StemLab edition. I don't remove any features of the base version. So, for example, if you are playing around in the future with a RapidTi or with a Hamlab, and you also have a Hermes board or whatever, an Anan, all the features that are used by the Anan and the other devices that are already on the market are still in there. Just select the other device as usual and you can use it. So I think there is no need to have more than one installations on your PC in the future. So what's changed in it? Let's start on the top side. It's a simple thing like the title bar. I negotiated with the guys from RapidTi to put in my current build and Git numbers here. This is just for the support. So if somebody of you is reporting bugs to RapidTi, RapidTi is the official supporter of this edition. I always know which build you are using to find the bugs very quickly and to not get in trouble with old versions or things like that. The version that I've built is currently running and tested on 32 and 64-bit Windows systems, starting with Windows XP up to Windows 10. So if you, I think you don't need to, but if you have other PowerSDR versions installed in parallel on your PC, you will get in trouble if you don't use a different configuration file path for your own PowerSDR version, for my version, because it will override each other's configuration files when you shut down the PowerSDR software. So I made a change here in the Charlie 25 edition, which is also used for Hamlab and StemLab, as I mentioned before. It is saving their own configurations in a different path, so there is no need to get in trouble here. You can use it in parallel if you want, for whatever reason. So what I've also already built in is an automatic software update functionality. The user is now informed when there is a new PowerSDR version from the Charlie 25 edition is available. It is looking on the download server from RapidTi when it has internet access. If it does not have at this time, no matter. It's just ignoring this request and running as usual. Then what's interesting for the guys playing around with the RapidTi, for now, you have to start up the RapidTi SDR application that Chad mentioned before for the Hamlab or for the Charlie 25 or the StemLab via the web browser before you start up PowerSDR. I extended the PowerSDR that it, when you power up PowerSDR, you click the power on button on the left top corner of PowerSDR, it is automatically starting up the SDR application on the RapidTi remotely. So no need to open a web browser before. Next slide. If you are playing around with more RapidTi devices in your network, PowerSDR can only work with one SDR application with one RapidTi at one time, of course. So I built in a small window that pops up when the software recognizes more than one RapidTi in your local area network, and it asks you which one to start up. So let's get a bit more into the hardware details, the support of the hardware. As Erwin and Edwin mentioned before, there are our own built TRX boards. So I now have two antenna connectors. Of course, my version of PowerSDR is supporting this one. Edwin also mentioned the coupler before. For the forward, backward, and SVR measurement, this support is already built in now. The attenuators and preamps that are there are supported so that you can freely switch between all the different levels of preamplification or attenuation. How have I realized this? All I said before, that I have not removed any features of the base version. I've added two device classes. The one is called Charlie 25. You can see it in the setup menu. And the second one is called HemLab/StemLab currently. You just select this device class, and PowerSDR knows how to handle the Red Pitaya and all our hardware behind. It's then automatically detecting the TRX port that is there, the RX filter boards that Edwin mentioned before. If you have them plugged in, they are optional. And also the audio codec that Jert showed you on the HemLab, and we are using also in the Charlie 25. Then I've put in own PA settings table for the Charlie 25 HemLab StemLab edition. So this means when you are using your Red Pitaya, let's say with another power amplifier, there are own power levels that can be put in there to make it compatible with it. It does not override the other PA settings that you are using, let's say, for your Anan receiver, for example. Then a nice feature, I think, that I've developed a few months ago. When you look on the top right side of the main window, you usually see the receiver's power level that's coming in. But now you have the attenuators and preamps in between. I've built in a calibration routine that's let you calibrate your special hardware to always show the right and the correct level on the antenna connector. It's not showing things like on a Japanese radio. It's showing the real signal level on the antenna connector. Of course, you have to calibrate it before. You need an RF signal generator. Put in the reference level you've set up on your RF signal generator, and then let the measurement and calibration routine run once per band. It's saved band by band, because there are different levels on different bands due to nonlinearity of preamps and attenuators, of course. So as I mentioned already before, the PowerSDR software here is also supporting the optional and in the future available RX bandpass filter boards that Edwin presented, the 12-band filter boards. And you can put in two of them, of course, for each receiver an own board. Then last but not least, we have done some extensions on the MIDI interface. When you come to our DRC booth, you can see our current prototype of the Charlie 25, where there is a rotary encoder in the front for the VFO dial knob, and this is what I made the extension in the MIDI interface software for. Then the next one are extensions in the setup menu. There are special test routines for the TX low-pass filters, which are on the TRX board, and the optional RX attenuator and RX preamps for a second receiver, and also for the first receiver, they are integrated on the TRX board. These functionalities are usually used in the production department of Red Pitaya. They are testing the HemLab hardware with it before they are sending them out to the customers. But as an end user, you can also use it for your own tests if you like to. So as Erwin and Edwin mentioned before, there are Another few ideas we already have, and of course, and the software will support them in the future, so I'm always in contact with them, as Erwin said before, twice a week. And I'm also in contact with RapidTire, usually once a week, to negotiate our development together. So this should be all from my side, guys. Thanks for listening. Any questions?